Hey, Noah, what's up?
Oh, hey, Pete. I forgot the combination on my locker.
Oh, that's a bummer. What are you going to do?
Well, fortunately, I left myself a secret message with the combination in it. All I have to do is decode it, and I'll be back in my locker in a jiffy.
A secret message?
That's right. Remember a couple episodes back when we talked about the cipher I made up back in high school? I decided to use my superior encryption creation skills again to encode my combination so that it would be super secure.
Really? Wow, that's cool.
See? I figured if I could encode letters into numbers, then I could just as easily encode numbers into letters. So I used a secret scheme that converts digits to a bunch of letters, and I'm the only one who can decode it.
O-N-E... T-E-N-S-E-V. Noah, is your combination 1-10-7?
How did you do that? That's amazing.
I don't think your secret scheme is very secret.
You don't? Oh, man. Now I'm thinking about that encrypted message I challenged you with at the end of our Diffie Hellman episode. Were you able to decode that just as easily?
Well, why don't we talk about it in this episode of the Math Club? Tales from Decrypt. All right, Dee. Well, there's a question I am dying to ask you. I have been waiting for a month and a half to ask you this question. I just looked at my email, and it was August 1st when I sent you this encrypted message. And it is now, as we're recording this, September 16th. So, were you able to decode my secret message?
Well, first off, I should tell you that it was September 15th that I opened that email.
You know, you've been waiting for a while. I might ask you to wait a little bit longer. So maybe before I tell you how far I got, why don't we dive in a little bit to talking about the process and sort of seeing how it unfolds?
Okay, you want to keep us all in suspense? We'll humor you for a little bit longer. Now, just to remind listeners, the way that this particular cipher works is every pair of letters gets encoded as a separate chunk into a different three-digit number. So, for example, AB might be 472, and TH might be 135. Also, the space between words counts as a character. So you'll remember we talked when we were setting up this challenge that the words "the math club," the encodable chunks would be TH, then E space, then MA, then TH, then space C, moving into the word club, then LU, and finally B space. And each one of those bigrams of letters encodes into a different three-digit number. Then you take all of those three-digit numbers and push them all together into one gigantic string of digits. And you might be interested to know, I checked this morning to see how many digits were in the message I sent you. And it had 2,193 digits. So what you received from me was just one long, unbroken string of about 2,200 digits. And I'm not going to read them all off right now. That would take actually about 15 minutes. But let me just read the first bit of it to give the listeners a glimpse of what you were dealing with. 2 9 4 0 9 9 8 5 9 2 1 0 0 6 7 2 8 5 4 7 2 2. That's only the first 22 out of about 2,200 digits. So it's only 1% of the total message. Now, you told me that even though you knew that my cipher took bigrams of letters and converted them into sets of three digits, that you were going to approach this task pretending like you didn't know that. So what did you do first? It would seem to me your first job, your first challenge was figuring out that it was sets of three digits that were meaningful. How successful were you in that first step?
Yeah, that really is the first step. Now, to be perfectly transparent here, I had to engage in some make-believe because I knew exactly how your cipher worked. So I had to set aside that knowledge and pretend that I was starting from scratch. So let's get our listeners in that same mindset. So they're on this journey with me, and we're pretending that we don't know how this works.
I'm pretending I don't know anything, which is a lot easier than you might.
It's a lot easier than it sounds. Right. So you sent me this long string of digits, 2000 characters, and I took it as my starting point that this is a substitution cipher. Because to be perfectly honest, maybe you sent me a giant block of text that had come out of some very sophisticated mathematical block cipher, like the advanced encryption standard. And obviously, like, that's off the table, right? I have to limit the realm of possibilities in some way. So I sort of took it for granted that, for starters, I'm going to assume this is a substitution cipher and then run a frequency analysis to see if that bears out. If this were output from a block cipher from AES or some other encryption scheme, the frequency analysis would just be meaningless. You would know right away, nope, this doesn't have any of the characteristic patterns that one expects from the frequency of English language characters.
I understand. So did you start off by just taking them as single digits to see if your frequency analysis gave you any meaningful content that way?
Yeah, that's exactly what I did. And of course, starting with single digits and calculating the frequencies. Do you know what I mean when I say calculating the frequencies?
I think you mean looking at how often each digit appears.
Yeah, so my code would sweep through the digits and it would say the digit zero occurred this many times, and then it would give me a relative percentage. In other words, it would say, I found zero 311 times, and that accounts for 11% of the total number of characters in the message. After doing that, it became pretty clear that there's no meaningful structure to those individual unigrams. They were just distributed in some seemingly random but fairly uniform way. Then I moved on to bigrams, which makes sense, right? If I'm dealing with 26 letters of the English language, then I would expect you're not going to collapse that down to just a 10 character alphabet, right? The digits 0 through 9 aren't going to be able to represent all 26 characters in the English language. So I thought, well, maybe there were bigrams involved, and those bigrams were a correspondence between pairs of letters to pairs of digits. Does that make sense?
Yeah. So how did your frequency analysis come out when you did it that way?
Well, it didn't correspond to the frequencies that I would expect from the English language. So then I looked at groups of 3 digits together. Now, I want to say a little bit here because I fudged something. Like, I did account for the fact that 1, you were using spaces, and 2, you were not using any other punctuation. So I did factor that into my thinking. But then I thought, well, how am I going to compare against a baseline? What is the frequency distribution for English language bigrams that contain spaces? I had to generate that. That wasn't readily available. So I had to go out, find a corpus of text, and generate that on my own.
So what did you use?
I used something which was called the Open American National Corpus. I downloaded just a ton of text from this website, and then I stripped out punctuation, I preserved spaces, I made sure there were never repeated spaces in a row, and then I said, for this huge body of text, megabytes and megabytes of text, generate the baseline frequencies for bigrams, and I used that as my starting point. When I ran the frequency analysis, assuming that triples of digits corresponded to something, something stood out. The frequencies matched this baseline very well. Not perfectly, but I would say convincingly well. So I thought, all right, well, let's see if triples of digits correspond to bigrams or pairs of letters. And that's when I compared against the baseline. When I did that, it looked like ding, 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 ding,
like I might have a winner. So that gave you your first toehold, I assume.
It did.
All right. At that point, you had determined that the meaningful chunks of the code were chunks of 3 digits and that each one corresponded to a 2-letter bigram. So How did you go from there into starting to actually decode the message?
So from there, I looked at the frequency table that I generated. So there were 192 of these triples, right? The 3-digit groupings, the trigrams in your ciphertext. 29 of them were the 3-digit number 057. So that's about 4% of the text was that triple. 27 of them were 099, slightly less, so roughly 3.7% of the text. Coming in third place is the trigram 294. There were 26 of those and so on. And I calculated this distribution to see exactly how many of each trigram occurred. And that's when you can start comparing and making guesses against the baseline. So for example, the most common two-letter bigram, according to my corpus, is E space.
Oh, that kind of makes sense because there are so many words in English that end with E and then would have a space right after them. So it would make sense that E space would be very common. Yeah, of course, not every word that ends with E is going to end up with that three digits because sometimes the E will go with the letter that precedes it. And sometimes the E will go with the space that comes right after it. But I would still assume there's a lot of E space. And it sounds like your analysis is bearing out that that's true.
Yeah. In fact, I found 3,023,749 of those bigrams in the corpus, accounting for 3.2%. So you'll notice that is less than what I found for the top ranking trigram in your ciphertext, right? That was 4%, okay? So already, anybody who thinks the way frequency analysis works is,
well, you just line up the numbers and Bob your uncle and here's the message. It's
not like that at all.
So
it is not like that at all. Bob is not my uncle. Bob is not, he's not even my uncle and I'm the guy doing the decryption. But again, we're talking about a global goodness of fit. The question is, on a global scale, if I look at all of the data, does the distribution look close enough to the baseline for me to assume that this is worth pursuing? And in this case, the answer is yes. Just because the top ranking blocks of text in each case don't align up perfectly, they're still close enough. And in fact, as it turns out, the top ranking three-digit number in your ciphertext does not correspond to the top ranking bigram in my baseline. It actually is the second one, right? So again, you're going to see that things aren't lining up exactly. However, first and second place, they're pretty close. We're talking among 729 possibilities. It's off by one. That's good enough, right? So
sure.
So this is the kind of analysis that got me started. I said, what are the top 10 trigrams from Noah's cipher?
Ladies and gentlemen, here's tonight's top 10 list. Let's go.
And then I said, what are the top 10 pairs of letters in the corpus? And I sort of said, all right, I'm going to figure out how these things align. And that was my starting point.
Gotcha. Now, I'm going to assume at that point that you've got, however you had your workspace set up, that you've got the encrypted text and you are slowly replacing encrypted bits with parts that you've cracked or parts that you solved. Now, at this point, you hadn't solved anything yet. But so you start to guess, okay, this one might be E space. And so I'm picturing that you just kind of go and fill in an E space, you know, everywhere that that triple digit shows up. How do you get from that to where you're actually starting to make some progress, where you can see some words starting to emerge from the murky, cloudy depths of encryption?
Yeah. By the way, it wasn't just the cloudy depths of encryption. It was also the murky depths of my misery because this was a lot of trials and error and slogging it out. And so, you know, I want to just say my hat is completely, I'm not even wearing a hat. That's how far off it's tipped towards the world's cryptographers because their jobs are not easy. And especially when it really counted, like in World War II, those folks, boy, did they earn their spots in history because they took on some really difficult work.
You haven't told us yet whether you were actually able to decipher this message, but I will admit to you that when I challenged you with this, I did not think you were going to be able to do it. So
I know. I know.
That, and I thought this was a very, very difficult undertaking. You said you thought that you felt pretty confident you could do it.
And so let me tell you, and let me tell the listeners, here's why Noah thought that this was going to be a very, very difficult thing to do. Not because I'm not, you know, capable enough of doing this, but it's because he thinks he invented an extra special, super secret, very, very, very difficult, clever, devious, ingenious cipher.
Okay, so I just want our listeners to know that's what's going on here.
I do not think that.
I know
you know that.
Okay. All right, smart
ass. All right. So then move us forward a little bit. Did you ever start to get words that would start to show up that would let you realize you're on the right track?
I did. And unfortunately, those words are the. So now I say plural words, and that's because, remember, you've included spaces in here. So there's two ways that the word the is going to show up: as TH followed by E space, or as space T followed by HE. And that space is a thorn in your side, at least initially. Later, you can leverage it, but initially, it just makes the murkiness that much murkier. So yes, the first two words, the first word, however we want to say it, that I nailed down was the word the. And I was very confident that I had the word the figured out. Next comes additional words, other words like other, that have the embedded in them. And so those words start to show up because sometimes I would find TH, but no E space coming after it. Then I started to think, all right, well, if this is THE something, what could it be? It could be a word like other. It could be a word like there. It could be a word like thesis. So you start to play around with, what could the next three-digit code represent, given that it follows TH? Okay. So this led me to nailing down the word other. That was, in fact, the next word that I figured out, followed by either. So the first three words that I had were the, other, and either.
Okay. And you must have just felt like $1 million when you got to the point where you had three words cracked.
Yeah. Well, you know, I did, but I wasn't 100% sure that I had it right because I only had so much frequency data to work with. So I was pretty confident that those were right, but I didn't feel it real strong in my gut.
All right. Well, now that brings me to something that I want to bring up. About 2/3 of the way through this endeavor, in fact, on August 31st, so 1 month in, 2 weeks ago, you told me that you were going to need a bit more encrypted text, that the passage I sent you just didn't have enough there for you to really do all the work you needed to do. And so you asked if I would be willing to send you a second encrypted message using the same key, the same mappings. So at that point, I sent you another passage that was pretty much the same length as the original one. So at this point, you had a little over 4,000 digits of encrypted text to work with. What did you do once you received that second bit of encrypted text? Well, what did you do next?
Well, let me take a step back from that question and first say that, you know, during the first 4 weeks, this may surprise listeners, but my full-time job isn't just hanging out at the math club. I have other stuff that I got to do and a family and all that kind of stuff, right? So it's not like I was nerves to the grindstone for 4 weeks on your cipher. But what became clear as I was working with just the single block that you sent me, that there really could be some variation between the rankings of the trigrams and what their actual bigram representation is relative to my corpus. And I thought, gosh, you know, if these are off by 2 or 3 or 4 or 5 spots in the ranking, I could be going down so many blind alleys. And how would I know? I just wouldn't really know. So I did toil for a few evenings with this idea of, okay, so if this next guess is right, I'm going to guess ER, but it could also be ES. So now I've got this bifurcation, like one timeline has me using ER and the other timeline has me using ES, and they could both be wrong.
The timeline skewed into this tangent, creating an alternate.
They can't both be right, but they could both be wrong. And I just thought, you know, there's so much uncertainty here that I need to get a little more data to feel confident. And frankly, it takes too much time to go down those blind alleys, right? And it's also not as fun as you might think. Initially, when you're just dealing with the blind alleys, it's a lot of like, ugh, is this right? I don't know. So that's when I said to you, hey, I think it would help expedite things and it would boost my morale to get another secret message. That's when you sent me ciphertext number two. Right away, I calculated the frequencies. I looked at them independent of one another, and I took their aggregate. So I knew now what the total frequency distribution of your trigrams is. And that was very clarifying. It moved things around in the rankings. I could see this accumulation of frequency counts coming together. And so that's when I said, all right, now I think my guesses are more reliable. And that's when I started to feel like $1 million, because I had the, I had other, I had either, I had or thought I had that. I put together the word together. And so now I've got, let's say, about 10 of these trigrams that I think with reasonably high confidence, I think I've got my hands on. And that's when I reached out to you and said, hey, I'm a little lonely doing this project. Can we get together and chat about it?
Yeah. And I remember while we were chatting, saying to you that it must be really difficult working on this all by yourself, because you don't have anyone else to kind of, one, bounce ideas off of, or two, to kind of celebrate your little successes that you get along the way. Like, you don't even have anyone to high five when you think you make a breakthrough. And so do you remember how you told me you were feeling at that point?
Oh, yeah. Like, you nailed it. I have always been a very social mathematician. When it comes to doing math, or in this case, computer science, however you want to frame this, I love collaborating. I want to work with people. And you nailed it. When you said those high fives, those little mini celebrations, you need those. You need to get a little boost. And I didn't have that. It was just me being like, okay, maybe OT is 419. Yeah. I don't know.
And I remember at that point, I don't remember if it was your idea or my idea, but we decided, hey, why don't we give you something to celebrate? Why don't you tell me one of the three-digit chunks that you feel like you've decoded, and I will look it up on my key, and I will tell you if you've got it right. You said, I think TH is 294, and I looked it up on my key and went all the way down the row to 294, and right next to it was TH, and man, I was blown away. I couldn't believe it. I mean, all you had done was basically decoded one bigram and told me what it was. And I was floored, Pete. I was so excited for you that you had that. And I told you, and I think at that point, you told me a few other three-digit chunks that you thought you had decoded, and every single one of them was right. Every single one of them.
In fact, we looked at the top seven. I had more, but I didn't want to go beyond it because I thought, I'm just going to name the ones I'm most confident about. I said, but what are the ones that I am really confident, like 90% or more? There were seven of those, and we went down the line. And I'll tell you, I was a little bit nervous about all of them. Like, I was like, okay, I'm confident, but here's where the rubber meets the road. Like, I'm going to say to Noah, okay, I think E space is 099. And you looked it up and you were like, yep. And I was like, okay. Then I started to calm down. Okay, what about space T? Is that 057? And you were like, it is. And then we just went down the list of the top seven. And that gave me such a boost. That was about 2 weeks ago, I think. And that gave me such a boost that I was like, all right, I can deal with this murky slog. I'm going to figure this out.
All right. So now let's head into the home stretch. You had this confidence boost. You knew you had at least your top seven bigrams were correct in what you had guessed that they were. I'm assuming that there's a point where, kind of like pushing a big boulder up a hill, and when you get to the peak, it sort of goes over the peak and then starts to roll down the other side. There must be a point in this process where you started to feel like, all right, things are really rolling now.
There is, but that didn't happen immediately. So I had seven in the bag. That meant I could lock down the text at that point. And I knew when I was staring at a TH somewhere in the text that it was a TH. There was no question about it. So then I began the process of looking for that tipping point, the one you just described, but I really wasn't there yet, because still all I had was a handful of very generic words, the, other, either. And I'll tell you, the ciphertext that you sent, it is not generic. It's got words in it like billions and olive skin and telemetry reports. So these were all things.
Well, maybe it does. I'm not confirming or denying that for you yet.
Noah, I'm telling you, it's there.
So I was looking for, that. Like, I had to fight my way out of generic land and get into specific town because I was not there at first. So I have in front of me the order in which I made these discoveries. So I told you about words like the and there and together and either and that. Then came words like, well, I found and, I found of. That was key. But I will tell you the moment that I got the biggest rush that I thought, I will break Noah's code. It's when the words chance meeting showed up in the text. As soon as I saw those two super specific words, chance meeting, what are the chances that those are wrong? You know, like, come on. So as soon as I found chance meeting, that's when I was like, all right, I am onto something, and I got the blood flowing, and I was all about like, I'm going to nail this.
Coincidentally,
I went to high school with a guy named Chance Meeting.
You did?
You know what that is? An incredible coincidence. And in fact, incredible is the next word I figured out after Chance Meeting. And I found out the word incredible, and right away I had incredible distances. And I thought, again, like, come on, incredible distances just magically showing up in my efforts and somehow they're not right. And I was like, no, they're right. And then I found things like they could have, I found encased in a sophisticated, like when I uncovered that phrase, I was like, whoa, what did Noah send me? and so it was really cool because you start to see these complex English language patterns emerging from what is otherwise still mostly a jumble of digits. It's mostly digits. Sporadically, you've got these little glimmers of light with the pairs of letters showing up. And then all of a sudden, you can start to see the underlying plain text emerge. And that was a total crush.
I got to tell you, several times over the last 6 weeks, I have opened up the encrypted text file that I sent you, just the one with the 2100 digits in it, and looked at it. And just in my head, I'm saying to myself, this just looks like a garbled bunch of numbers, but there is meaning here. I had no idea how to get that meaning out of it, but Pete is working on this and he's getting somewhere.
Yeah. Cause I almost was like, dude, this is more time consuming than I really want it to be. But I will tell you this, and this is stepping slightly outside the world of mathematics and computer science. What got me through was a little bit of that morale boost, which tells me it's important when working on hard problems to have collaborators. That's really important. You need those boosts of morale. But the other thing that is super important, and I think if there's a teacher out there who's listening to this podcast, if there are students out there listening to this podcast, just employees of any company, you've got to have the tenacity and the grit to stick it out. And I almost didn't. I almost gave up because it was too much work. But I didn't. And I'm glad I didn't, because the rush that I got at each stage, I wouldn't have gotten. And I would have just felt like, I could have solved that if I didn't give up. Well, okay, maybe you could have, but you don't know because you gave up, right?
So yeah. Well, I got to say, Pete, I know you're purposely not letting us know yet if you were successful in decoding this message, but you are definitely giving signals that make it sound to me like you are going to tell us you did it. But before I ask that question again, I want to talk for a minute about how I chose the passage that I was going to send to you. At first, I was going to send you the Wikipedia article on the history of podcasting. I went to that piece of text and I started looking through it. And the first thing I noticed was it had the word podcast, podcasts, podcaster, and podcasting probably like 20 times in the course of a page. And that made me think this might not be a good thing to send to you. Either it would make it too easy or it might make it too hard because you didn't have enough variation in what the words were. So I abandoned that idea and started thinking about what could I use. Now, I know that one stipulation of our agreement about this challenge was that as you started to decode chunks of words, like, for example, chance meeting, or encased in a sophisticated, you promised that you would not Google any of those sections of text as you decoded them, because it might help you to determine what the whole text was. I knew that you promised not to do that, and I trusted you wouldn't do that, but I added an extra layer of protection by not sending you text that would appear anywhere on the internet. And what I actually sent you was, in keeping with the theme of my high school cipher, which was something I created years and years ago that I never did anything with, it reminded me of my novel that I
wrote. Oh my gosh,
years ago. I can't believe this. My novel that I wrote years and years ago and never did anything with. So what you have in your encrypted passage number one is the first page of a science fiction novel that I tried to write about 25 years ago.
Oh my God.
What I wonder is if you noticed when you got the second passage was that it was the very next page, that it comes immediately after the first passage that you decoded. Did you notice that there was a similarity in these passages that would indicate that they came from the same source text?
I was under the impression that they were just randomly chosen from who knows where, but I had assumed that they were unrelated to each other. And I later started to piece together that at least in terms of like their themes, they were related, but I didn't know that they were authored by the same person. I know that now.
Interesting.
But I didn't know that earlier.
Well, that first page is one complete scene, and then the next page switches to an entirely different scene. So it wasn't like it went from one sentence at the end of passage one right into a sentence at the beginning of passage two that was part of the same paragraph or anything like that. But I was curious if, as you looked at these passages, if it was going to become clear that they had a lot more in common than maybe you thought at the beginning.
Well, what I began to realize, at first I thought that the passages were from a fantasy novel. And I'll tell you specifically, I at one point thought the word monsters was in the text. It wasn't. I also thought the word Merlin showed up. And it took me a little while to back my way out of Merlin, because I thought, okay, that's a very specific and somewhat rare word. This could be a text about, you know, the Knights of the Round Table. I don't know. But it turns out what I thought initially was Merlin turned out to be the word merely. I had the trailing N was wrong. So there is no N. It was actually a Y, but it took me a little bit to figure that out. But in terms of the theme, there are some words that show up in common. I now think these are science fiction passages, not fantasy passages. But like the word designer, I think the word computer shows up in both. So, yeah.
All right, Pete, I think we're at the big moment. I want to know if you were able to decode the entire passage. I can already tell from the way you're talking that I think you got at least a good deal of it. But I want to know, inquiring minds want to know, were you able to decode the entirety of the encrypted messages that I sent you?
Well, let me answer your question this way. The computers, of course, did not care to ponder the significance or the improbability of their encounter. They merely noticed each other and executed slight deviations in their respective courses to bring them closer together. Two machines, each encased in a sophisticated propulsion and guidance system, hurtling through deep space. They could have easily computed the probability that they would cross paths, but it is doubtful that they could have even begun to compute the significance. Even their designers, had they been there, would not have had the ability to foresee the chain of events which would be initiated by this chance meeting.
All right, I'm going to stand. It goes on because my jaw is on the floor. So first, let me pick that up. I have to tell you, I opened up my copy of the original text while you were reading that so I could read along. And that was amazing. You nailed it. You had it word for word. And I am confident that if I asked you to keep reading the rest of the two pages, that you would have it. Hey, Math Club. This is Noah from the future breaking in to let you know that after our recording session ended, I did make Pete read his entire two pages of decrypted text to me so I could check it out. And believe it or not, he had it 100% correct. Every single word. Okay, back to the episode. Pete, I'm just super impressed at what you were able to do here. But I do have one last question for you. Actually, it's a couple of questions, but they all kind of encompass the same idea. Was this test easier than you thought it was going to be? Was it harder than you thought it was going to be? Was it about what you thought? And what was the hardest part?
Yeah, you know, it was about as hard as I thought. It was a little bit harder. But I should say, I used to teach a course on cryptography to liberal arts majors. And I would give them, as an assignment, frequency analysis of a substitution cipher. And they would complain, oh, this is so hard. This is taking a lot of time. And I would always be like, that's okay. You'll get through it. And now I feel the same pain that I subjected them to. I think this is harder than just a straightforward letter for letter substitution cipher. I don't think it's a lot harder. I do think it's a little harder. And there were a couple of spots where I got a little tricked out and I had to have some fun playing with words. Like I mentioned earlier, I thought the word Berlin was in the text and it wasn't. At the very end of this first message that you sent me, let me just read this because I really do think this is super cool. You write, two powerful signals shot out from their location in opposite directions, each one holding all of the information of the encounter, but only one of them still had someone listening at the other end. I like that. That's great writing. But I think in particular, that last expression at the other end, that was one of the first areas that I zoomed in on. And for a long time, I thought it was on the other hand. I was like, oh yeah, on the one hand, da, da, da. And this, and on the other hand, and I sort of thought, and I spent a bit of time thinking it was hand. And then I backed off and I was like, look, you're buying too much. You're putting too much stock in this guess. What if you back out of it? And then eventually I got at the other end, but I had no idea you were talking about someone listening at that end. Like that was a cool surprise when that emerged from the work that I was doing. So
interesting.
I will say for listeners, that largely speaking, this was really not a mathematical exercise. This was more an interdisciplinary exercise that involved mathematics, computer science, natural language processing, the English language itself, and a good bit of scrappiness. Like I had to go and figure out how to get frequency data that had spaces in the letters. Like that's, you can't just look that up. Like you got to figure that out. And that's when I said, I'm going to grab my own corpus and calculate those frequencies on my own. All told, this was ultimately a very rewarding exercise. It was harder than I thought going in. It ended up being really fun to see the actual text emerge at the end, but it was a slog. I keep using that word. It was tough in the beginning. I was like in a swamp full of molasses and mosquitoes, and I was like, I don't like it here. So anyway, Noah, thank you for this challenge. It was ultimately quite rewarding.
I'm glad that you found it rewarding. And I'm also super excited that you were able to crack it. I also feel like a little bit vindicated that this code isn't something that would just be easily crackable. Like if when I was back in high school, I had decided to actually use this with a friend to send secret messages back and forth, I'm pretty confident that most of my high school peers would not have been able to intercept those messages and do what you did and decode them.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Totally. Like if I didn't know frequency analysis, which I learned while I was teaching that cryptography class I was talking about, there's no way. I mean, this is for all intents and purposes, this is a very secure mechanism. You know, like, yes, people who break codes for a living could figure it out, but in general, no, your message is pretty safe.
Good to know.
Well,
Pete, would you like to let our listeners know how they can contact us if they have questions or comments about the episode or would like to suggest topics for future episodes of the Math Club?
Sure. And here's what I will tell them. 294-099-859-210-06.
Wait a second. They're not going to be able to. We just
determined that they're not going to be able to decode that.
Could you tell them in plain text, please?
In plain text. Hey, Math Club, as always, we would absolutely love to hear from you. You can send us an email. Our address is mathclubpodcast@gmail.com. Or why not reach out to us on Twitter? Our handle,
at Math Club Podcast.
All right, everybody. Thank you for joining us today, and we will see you next time.
Bye, everybody. Talk to you soon.
863-495.